Neuroendocrine tumors are cancers that can occur throughout the body. Generally, we don't understand why people get these cancers. There's certain sort of genetic syndromes, but they're rare. Normally, they occur sporadically. And the majority of times, they tend to start out somewhere in the abdomen. So I see them in the small intestine, pancreas, colon, rectum. But up to about 25-30% of the time, they start out in the lung. And many times when they start out in the lung, they can be asymptomatic. So patients can get diagnosed because they get a scan for another reason. You know, maybe they have some sort of abdominal problem, and they get a scan of the abdomen, and it picks up something at the bottom of the lung, and then they go on this journey to this diagnosis. One of the other ways they get picked up, diagnosed, is through symptoms. And the symptoms can vary. They sort of mimic our normal, so our non-small cell or small cell lung cancer. They can go from shortness of breath or cough or wheezing. Sometimes people can cough up blood. Weight loss can come along with this if the cancer is spread. It spreads to the bone. Sometimes people get bone pain associated with this. But this is all, the symptoms really vary from patient to patient. It's a very good question. So neuroendocrine cancers of the lung vary in terms of degrees of aggressiveness. So they represent, when we look at the totality of lung cancer, this represents probably about 20% of all lung cancers. But when we start talking about some of the lower grade tumors, so things that we're going to talk about today, the typical and atypical carcinoid tumors, this only represents about 2% of lung cancers. So we break them into degrees of aggressiveness. So from very, very indolent tumors are very, very aggressive, and they're classified that way. So the fastest growing tumors that we see, the neuroendocrine tumors that we see, are something called small cell lung cancer. We see this primarily in patients who have a long smoking history, and it tends to be a very aggressive lung cancer. Take it down a notch, underneath that is large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma. So not as aggressive, but still a very aggressive lung cancer. And then when we come down even further, we see something called an atypical carcinoid tumor. And then down further to the more indolent tumors is a typical carcinoid. So if you look at the literature, the percentage is very low. Some series say 2%, some people say 10%. In my experience, patients may have this a little more often than that, but the majority of these cancers are what we call non-functional. So they're not secreting hormones that produce the syndrome. They can certainly, you know, it's not just carcinoid syndrome, but they can produce other types of hormones as well that can cause something called Cushing's or acromegaly. So there's other types of hormones that we look for, but the actual percentages are minimal. But I think I think it's somewhat evolving as well. So I see them, and I'm seeing more and more like this. I don't know if there's breast cancer being very common. We see this, especially since, you know, many times with the carcinoid tumors, this can be a very, a long course of disease. So, you know, we see this more and more. So I think finding out, you know, I think the biggest thing is, you know, if you have one cancer and now all of a sudden you have a nodule, you know, they do a biopsy to make sure this is not metastatic disease from the original cancer. But if it's a carcinoid tumor, you know, you treat it as such, with definitive treatment. If it's metastatic, well then you treat it as a metastatic disease. But as far as we certainly do see neuroendocrine tumors happen with other types of cancers, not just breast cancer, but all different types of cancers I see. The biggest thing that I see that is a problem is people not understanding this disease, and not patients, but physicians. And I think patients need to be their own best advocate about this. You know, I see many patients that have come through and they get told, oh, you had a benign tumor, we took it out, you don't need anything else. Well, that's the absolute wrong thing. You know, seek out other opinions. You know, we collaborate with people from around the country, around the world, and provide a roadmap for care. You know, your doctors are not going to be upset at you if you say, can I go get another opinion? If they are upset at you, well, then maybe you should go get another opinion anyway. You know, so get your specialty opinions, you know, from your neuroendocrine centers, and, you know, we're not stealing any of their patients. You know, sometimes that's a fear from other docs saying, oh, they're going to steal my patient. We work with them. You know, we provide a roadmap for care for them. And 99% of the time, they are very happy because they may have two patients with a carcinoid tumor in their entire practice. They see lung and breast and colon cancer all day long. And then twice a year, someone with carcinoid comes in and they're more than happy to say, go to the expert, but come back to me and you get your injections, you get your other treatment, but a few times a year you go and see the specialist. So that's the big thing. You know, this is your disease. And at the end of the day, you know, I think taking control of it and really, you know, being your own patient advocate really goes a long way.